Check. 1, 2, 3. Okay. Well, Lindsay already said it, but happy Mother's Day. This is my first opportunity to preach on Mother's Day. And I'm so thankful that God allowed me to be born into a home of loving parents. And we will find in the scriptures that Proverbs is full of instructions to children from the parents. And I cannot think of a sweeter passage than Proverbs 31. Maybe you've heard it as the good wife or the faithful wife, the wise wife, the virtuous woman. It's got many titles. This is the last section of Proverbs, and it is encapsulating the goodness and the beauty of a woman who fears the Lord and honors her husband. And if there's no PowerPoint again, that's okay. I have the notes, and we can follow along together. So if you have a copy of the scriptures, I invite you to turn to Proverbs 31, starting in verse 10. Earliest memories of my mother teaching me was two words. She said, "Be humble." As a youngster, I remember the first time I heard those words, I didn't understand what she was talking about. I had no idea. She was trying to correct me. I was probably sad and upset or something, and she was encouraging me to be humble. And she's this, you know, 5-foot-nothing little Japanese woman. And so in her English as a second language, she would say, "Daniel, be humble." And that just stuck in my mind for so long. Until this day, I can still hear her voice encouraging me to be humble. And man, how impactful that has been in my life. And I'm so thankful that if I remembered anything from my earliest childhood memories, and obviously she taught me so much more, but how awesome. And I'm so thankful that she instilled that in my life at a young age. So if you're there with me, I encourage you to follow along in Proverbs 31. I'm reading out of the ESV translation. And so we're going to read verses 10 through the end, through 31. So bear with me. As we read God's word together, I'm going to pray and ask God to help us this morning. Lord, thank you for your word. Lord, thank you that we have access to it. Lord, thank you that we have it in a language that we can understand, that we can share. Lord, we acknowledge that there are people in this world that don't have access to your word. Lord, they've never heard the name of Jesus. They don't know the good news of salvation through him, dying on the cross for all of their sin and rising again on the third day. So, Lord, today we want to remember those who yet have not heard, and we want to pray for missionaries on the field who are working to get the gospel to those who have not yet heard. Lord, we pray along with Jesus when he said, "Pray that the Lord of the harvest would send laborers into the field. The harvest is ready, but the laborers are few." Lord, would you burden us for the lost? Would you give us boldness and courage to speak your truth to those who have not yet heard? Lord, whether it be our neighbors, our friends, our relatives, our associates, Lord, would you give us opportunity to share your word? Help us to be transformed by your word today. And we ask it in the name of Jesus. Amen. An excellent wife, who can find? She is far more precious than jewels. The heart of her husband trusts in her, and he will have no lack of gain. She does him good and not harm all the days of her life. She seeks wool and flax and works with willing hands. She is like the ships of the merchant. She brings her food from afar. She rises while it is yet night and provides food for her household and portions for her maidens. She considers a field and buys it. With the fruit of her hands, she plants a vineyard. She dresses herself with strength and makes her arms strong. She perceives that her merchandise is profitable. Her lamp does not go out at night. She puts her hand to the distaff, and her hands hold the spindle. She opens her hand to the poor and reaches out her hand to the needy. She's not afraid of snow for her household, for all her household are clothed in scarlet. She makes bed coverings for herself. Her clothing is fine linen and purple. Her husband is known in the gates, and when he sits among the elders of the land, she makes linen garments and sells them. She delivers sashes to the merchants. Strength and dignity are her clothing, and she laughs at the time to come. She opens her mouth with wisdom, and the teaching of kindness is on her tongue. She looks well to the ways of her household and does not eat the bread of idleness. Her children rise up and call her blessed, her husband also, and he praises her. Many women have done excellently, but you surpass them all. Charm is deceitful and beauty is vain, but a woman who fears the Lord is to be praised. Give her of the fruit of her hands, and let her works praise her in the gates. So, the structure of this passage is pretty important. So in your notes, if you want to follow along, the structure of this psalm is an acrostic poem, meaning that in the Hebrew language, every verse starts with the corresponding next letter of the Hebrew alphabet. So verses 10 through 31, you find 22 letters beginning this poem. Why is the structure important? Because it's intentional. The author is purposeful when he's writing this poem. And not only is it an acrostic, but also it's a chiasmus. Chiasmus is C-H-A-I-S-M-U-S. Chiasmus. And in your notes, I have the diagram. I got it from the New American Commentary. And this is helpful for us to understand and see that the structure of this poem points us to something. You'll find chiasmus a lot in the scriptures, oftentimes in Proverbs. And what is it doing? It's drawing your attention to a central point. So you have to consider, like, in the Hebrew language, there is no underlining, right? There's no exclamation marks. There is no bold lettering that you can use. So what are they going to use? They're going to use repetition, right? There's no emojis, right, in the Bible that we can use to help communicate action, emotion, these type emphasis. And so this structure is really key for this portion of Scripture. And in the very center, you see that the public, the commentator says that verse 23, her husband is known in the gates, and when he sits among the elders of the land. So I assure you that this passage of Scripture is not a to-do list for women. This is not to be a comparison game in saying, hey, ladies, you need to be more like this because this is what the virtuous woman does. Right? We want to be mindful that this is not the intention of the author. The author's intention, we have to look at verse 1, 2, and 3. And it's the words of King Lemuel, the oracle which his mother taught him. And she says, wait, what, O my son? And what, O my son of my womb? And what, O son of my vows, do not give your strength to women or the ways in which destroys kings. This is a mother giving her son wise counsel. And what is she saying? She's saying, look out, son. This is the type of woman you want to look for. The virtuous woman. The woman who is going to be helping you be successful in your life. If you want to have a successful life, right? Verse 23 is like the only verse in this passage that highlights the husband. And rightly so, because it's the middle point of the chiasmus. It's the middle theme of this passage. And if you look at these 22 verses, the themes, the correlating themes that come prior and that come after relate to each other very well. It's pretty sweet. It's very poetic. And so we learn a lot, right? Proverbs says a lot about the parent-to-child relationship. So we think about the original context of what this writer is communicating. And it's so evident to see in so many portions of the New Testament, of the Proverbs. So Proverbs 1:8 says this: hear, my son, your father's instructions, and forsake not your mother's teaching. Proverbs 6:20 says this: my son, keep your father's commandment and forsake not your mother's teaching. Proverbs 10:1, a wise son makes a father glad father, but a foolish son is a sorrow to his mother. Proverbs 15:20 says, a wise son makes a glad father, but a foolish man despises his mother. Proverbs 19:26 says, he who does violence to his father and chases away his mother is a son who brings shame and reproach. Proverbs 20:20 says, if one curses his father or his mother, his lamp will be put out in utter darkness. Proverbs 23:22 says this: listen to your father who gave you life, and do not despise your mother when she is old. Proverbs 23:25 says, let your father and mother be glad. Let her who bore you rejoice. Proverbs 28:24 says, whoever robs his father or his mother and says, that is no transgression, is a companion to a man who destroys. Proverbs 29:15 says, the rod and reproof give wisdom, but a child left to himself brings shame to his mother. Proverbs 30, verse 17 says, the eye that mocks a father and scorns to obey a mother will be picked out by the ravens of the valley and eaten by the vultures. That's so graphic. I'm so glad I wear glasses, right? Proverbs 30, verse 17. The eye that mocks a father and scorns to obey a mother will be picked out by the ravens of the valley and eaten by the vultures. Proverbs has a ton to say about the relationship between parents and children. And man, I cannot emphasize so much that the opportunity we have as parents to influence the children God has given us. And I'm so thankful that Lindsay alluded to not only it's your own children, right? But it's also your spiritual children. It's the young ones that you've gotten to take underneath your wing and share life with them and share truth with them, right? Because you want what's best for them. Man, I'm so thankful that my mother took the time to teach me so many good things, so many helpful things. And I think we can all testify to those types of mothers in our life. So we want to look back at the passage, and this is a time for a little interaction, okay? You have to speak up. I want to hear. I have the privilege of teaching God's word, and I'm so convinced that when you interact, you get more out of it, right? When you hear something, you remember 10% of it. When you see something, you remember 50% of it. When you do something, you're more likely to remember 90% of it. And so, looking through the copy of your scripture, right, Proverbs 31, verses 10 through 31, what are the themes and the characteristics, the character traits that you find for this virtuous, excellent wife? Strength, right? She's got strong arms. I consider a mother of young children, right? She's carrying 10 to 30 pounds all day long. So imagine the workout that she gets every day, up and down, up and down, up and down, up and down. Pick me up, put me down, pick me up, put me down. Swing me, swing me, swing me. No, absolutely. Wisdom, absolutely. What is she teaching? And does she fear the Lord? Truth. Planning, absolutely. Right? It says she doesn't fear winter. She laughs at the future. Why? Because she's so prepared. She has planned well. She works hard. Absolutely. What's that? She's disciplined. Absolutely. It's not just a job. She's concerned. A lot of love. Absolutely. She is trusted. Compassionate. Absolutely. Consider the margin that she has in her life to be able to be, to look out for the needy. Industrious. Absolutely. Hardworking. Yep, she fears the Lord. She is kind. She's a servant. Absolutely. And yeah. Sure. She's honorable, humble, a good reputation, yeah. Mm-hmm. A leader, sure. Loyal. Guards her tongue. This was my list. I said valuable, trustworthy, diligent work ethic, not lazy, a provider, business-minded, understands value, future-minded, physically strong, perceptive, willing to work long hours, right? Where it talks about how her lamp doesn't go out at night. It's like the verse right before it, she's talking about making profit from the things that she makes with her hands. So what is she going to do? She's going to go through the night and still work on those things so that her lamp doesn't go out. Willing to work long hours, she's handy, she's compassionate to the poor, she's well-prepared, she's wise, she's kind, and she fears the Lord. Last week, if you were here or if you watched the recording of Travis's sermon, he asked the question of, how do you smell? Right? When he first asked that question, I thought, with my nose. But he was implying, right, what do you smell like? And man, I was really challenged by that and saying, does our aroma bring Christ-likeness to the people around us? Do we get to be salt? Are you intentionally seeking to be salt and light, not for your own glory, but to show a watching world how awesome our God is and that he is worthy of following. He is worthy of obeying. He is good. And he is so good. The one that I just want to focus on for us is that, there's two. The first one is that she fears the Lord. And everything stems from our relationship with the Lord. Right? We talk about fears, like I'm afraid of spiders, or I'm afraid of bugs, or I'm afraid of, lightning. Living in Florida, I hope you have a healthy fear of lightning, right? Maybe you've known somebody who has been struck by lightning, or I've known somebody whose brand new truck was so close to a lightning strike that all the electronics just fried inside this brand new Ford F-150, and that was a humbling lesson to see. Right? We have these healthy fears, and what do these fears do? They control you. Right? When you see a spider, you might scream, right? And you will not go in that room until your husband goes in and takes care of the spider, or whoever it is who's responsible for killing bugs. It controls you. And so we recognize, oftentimes we talk about the fear of the Lord, and it's a deep reverence, and I agree to that. But I think it's so much more that when you fear the Lord, he controls you. You recognize who he is and what he has done, and you allow him to have authority in your life. Right? Just like that spider, that unfortunate spider, has a lot of authority and stops you from going into that room. Man, I pray that God would instill in you a right understanding of who he is and what he has done. And I think that without the fear of the Lord, none of these other things would really be appropriate. Right? If there is no judge, why not live life just for yourself? Right? Why wouldn't we just be merry and die? If there is no God, there is no set moral compass for anyone to live by. And so I pray and I hope that we embrace the fear of the Lord. Proverbs talks about that is the beginning of knowledge. Psalm says that the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. You cannot appropriately live life unless you have a clear perspective of who God is and what he has done. And so as a reminder of many of us, but maybe you've never heard, I don't know each and every person here, but maybe you don't know who this Lord is. And I would call myself a failure if I didn't take just a moment to highlight who this Lord is that we talk about, that we sing about, that we praise. This Lord is the creator of all things. This Lord is the God of the universe who is all-powerful and all-knowing. And in the beginning, he created everything good. And he allowed man a choice. The choice to either obey him or to disobey him. Why? Because love has to have a choice. It's not love if you don't have a choice. So God didn't make us to be robots. He made us to have this free will. And unfortunately, the first humans to walk on this earth chose to disobey. And the good creation was tainted with sin. Sin is not of God. Sin is not of his creation. But he allowed it to enter into this world, and he gave man hope that he would restore this brokenness, this sin. And he did that through his son, whom he sent, Jesus the Christ, the second person of the Godhead, God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit, we believe is three in one. They're all equally God, but their roles are different. And the role that Jesus had to play was to become a man. 2,000 years ago, we believe that he was born of the Virgin Mary. He lived a perfect, sinless life. And because he was perfect and sinless, he could be a rightful substitute for our sinfulness. He took on all the sin of man and died on the cross for all of our sin. The Bible says that without the shedding of blood, there is no forgiveness of sins. And Jesus willingly paid for every single one of our sins. And when he died, he stayed dead for 3 days. But on the third day, he rose again. Proving what? That he conquered death. He conquered sin. That he is actually God. And he is able to offer forgiveness. He is able to offer new life. And that is why we love him, because of who he is and what he has done for us. And we fear the Lord because he is all-powerful and all-knowing. And he is worthy of surrendering your life to. And so if you've never come to the point in time in your life where the Bible says that it is by grace you have been saved through faith, it's not of yourself. It is a gift of God, not of works, lest anyone should boast. The gift of salvation is free, completely free. If you think it's about you doing good things, then it's not free. It has to be free. And so if you've never come to the place in your life where you've accepted that free gift of salvation, I encourage you to allow that day to be today. And the Bible says that all you have to do is believe. John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. That's it. You just have to believe. But this is what you're believing. You're believing that Jesus is enough. That it's only Jesus. It's nothing else. And if that's what you believe, then the Word of God says that you are saved. That you have forgiveness of sins. That you have now been, you were a child of Satan, dead in your sin. And now, because of what you believe about Jesus, you're in his family. You're in God's family. And all of your sins are forgiven. And you get to be a child of God. That's it. That's the gospel. That is the good news. That is why we have church. That is why there are Christians in this world, is because of the message that Christ died for your sins and he rose from the grave. And it's because of what God has done. That is why we fear the Lord. That is why this woman can be virtuous, selfless. It's not about her. It's all about what she can do for others. Why? Because God has fully satisfied her. And we get to live that way too. As an application to receiving the gospel, you recognize that God has satisfied all of my wants and all of my needs. All the attention, all the approval, all the acceptance that you could ever hope for and want can be found in Christ Jesus. And that is our hope, and that is our joy, and that is our love. So this Proverbs 31 is not a to-do list, right? It's not a comparison game. But there are so many principles, right, to draw from this in saying that there are so many good things we can do in this world. Noble things, honorable things. Why? Because we are able to see the goodness of God and reflect that goodness to the people around us. The fear of the Lord. This proverb this poem at the end of the book of Proverbs is really a, it shows that the book of Proverbs has come full circle. So we talked a little bit about what mothers and fathers can do in their relationship with their children, mainly their son, right? The majority of the book of Proverbs is geared towards the son. My son, my son. Why? Because the guys need more help than girls, obviously, right? They're not talking about daughters, right? It's always talking about the son. We're hard-headed, and we need the most help, is my personal takeaway from this. All throughout Proverbs, you have this comparison of the foolish versus the wise person. And all throughout Proverbs, wisdom is always personified as a woman. So it's almost as if all throughout the book of Proverbs, you have this hypothetical woman who is wise, who is wisdom. And then at the end of Proverbs, you actually see what this wise woman, this mother, this wife, does. And consider all the principles that she is looking out for: the good, the best, the wholesome, everything in her life in reflection to fearing the Lord. So I thought that these two passages of Proverbs are really helpful and in taking a picture of these two things, the beauty of wisdom and the terribleness of foolishness. Terribleness is a bad word. The foolishness of not fearing the Lord. So in Proverbs chapter 3, verse 13 through 18, I encourage you to turn there, but I'll read it for us. Proverbs 3, 13 through 18. Blessed is the one who finds wisdom and the one who gets understanding. And listen for the correlation, right, between Proverbs 31 and Proverbs 3. Blessed is the one who finds wisdom and the one who gets understanding. For the gain of her from her is better than the gain from silver, and her profit better than gold. She is more precious than jewels, and nothing you desire can compare with her. Long life is in her right hand, and her left hand are riches and honor. Her ways are ways of pleasantness, and all her paths are peace. She is a tree of life to those who lay hold of her. Those who hold her fast are called blessed. And in comparison, Proverbs 26 says, verses 6 through 12. This is the unfortunateness of foolishness. Whoever sends a messenger by the... I love the pictures of Proverbs, right? Whoever sends a message by the hand of a fool cuts off his own feet and drinks violence. Like a lame man's legs, which hang useless, is a proverb in the mouth of a fool. Like one who binds a stone in a sling is one who gives honor to a fool. Like a thorn that goes up into the hand of a drunkard is a proverb in the mouth of fools. There's chiasmus here. It's kind of cool. Like an archer who wounds everyone is one who hires a passing fool or drunkard. Like a dog that returns to his vomit is a fool who repeats his folly. Do you see a man who is wise in his own eyes? There is more hope for a fool than for him. Consider that. Man, they paint this picture of this foolish person. Man, it is like something to be pitied, right? It's like seeing an accident that's about to happen and you can't stop it. You just want to cringe and you're saying, oh no, this is not a good thing. But look at how it crescendos, and it's building up this point. Who is the greatest fool? Man, in verse 12, the greatest fool is the prideful man. So what's worse than being a fool? Being a proud fool, right? The ultimate fool is the proud man. And so you see this contrast, right, between the wise personified woman of wisdom. And then you see the culmination of that in Proverbs 31. An excellent wife, who can find? She is far more precious than jewels. The heart of her husband trusts in her, and he will have no lack of gain. She does him good and not harm all the days of her life. She seeks wool and flax and works with willing hands. She's like a ship of the merchant. She brings her food from afar. She rises while it is yet night and provides food for her household and portions for her maidens. She considers a field and buys it. With the fruit of her hands, she plants a vineyard. She dresses herself with strength and makes her arms strong. She perceives that her merchandise is profitable and her lamp does not go out at night. She puts her hand to the distaff, and her hands hold the spindle. She opens her hands to the poor and reaches out her hands to the needy. She's not afraid of snow for her household, for all her household are clothed in scarlet. She makes bedding for herself. Her clothing is fine linen and purple. Her husband is known in the gates, and when he sits among the elders of the land, she makes linen garments and sells them. She delivers sashes to the merchants. Strength and dignity are her clothing. She laughs at the time to come. She opens her mouth with wisdom, and the teaching of kindness is on her tongue. She looks well to repay. She looks well to the ways of her household and does not eat the bread of idleness. Her children rise up and call her blessed, her husband also, and he praises her. Many women have done excellently, but you surpass them all. Charm is deceitful and beauty is vain, but a woman who fears the Lord is to be praised. So charm and beauty are not terrible, but if those are the only two things you have and you don't have the fear of the Lord, they are deceitful and vain. Give her of the fruit of her hands and let her works praise her in the gates. So mothers, we are so thankful for your selflessness. Thank you, mothers, for your kindness. I get to go to work. I work for Word of Life, and I spend about 40 hours a week in my workplace. But a mother's role, right, is 24/7, right? We are thankful for the nights that we get to sleep through the night. But those aren't always promised. And then I hear when you get older, it doesn't happen either because of other things. But man, can I encourage ladies, mothers, to not grow weary in doing good? Your labor is not in vain. And I recognize that we have different stories. We have different people in our lives. Maybe you have a wayward child, right? Maybe you have a mother who does not fear the Lord. And so I want to take time to pray and to ask God to help us in our relationships with the people that we have in our lives, especially what we say is difficult, it's heartbreaking. Right, you want what's best for them. You want what's good for them. You want them to taste and see that the Lord is good. You want them to experience the blessedness of being obedient to God and loving Him with all your heart, mind, soul, and strength. My encouragement for us is to continue to seek to fear the Lord. Maybe there's an area of your life. We talked about many of the themes and the character traits of a wise and excellent woman. And obviously for the men here, we see these character traits and we want them too. So guys, this is for us too. And as we apply the scripture to our lives, we too want to be found trustworthy, honorable, be men of integrity, kindness. We want to be compassionate, right? We want to speak the truth. We want to be wise. We want to fear the Lord. Let's pray. Lord, we need you. Lord, we have, I know many of us have heavy hearts of dear family members, of mothers maybe specifically who don't know you yet, who maybe have walked away from you. Lord, we're thankful for the examples of women who have kept the faith and they are running the race and they are serving you diligently and selflessly all the days of their life. And we are humbled that you would allow us to know them. And Lord, we are asking that you would help us to relate with them well. Lord, we don't want to harden their hearts towards the gospel. We don't want to harden our hearts towards you, Father. But Lord, we're asking that you would soften their hearts. If they don't know you, if they're far from you, Lord, if it's a son or a daughter that's wayward, and maybe Mother's Day is difficult, Lord, maybe you have faced the heartache of losing a child, maybe through miscarriage, maybe through a child who's died before you. And Lord, we're asking that you would comfort those who are grieving, who are mourning. Lord, we're asking that you would give us eyes of compassion to see those who are hurting around us and to love them, to be with them. Lord, give us eyes to see. Lord, thank you that we have hope in you. God, thank you that we can fear you and our lives can be a reflection of your goodness in our lives. God, thank you that you alone are worthy of all the glory and all the honor and all the praise. Lord, would you protect us from thinking that it's our good works that save us, that make us pleasing to you. Help us to remember the gospel and that it's just Jesus that makes us eternally pleasing to you, God. And every good thing that we get to do is just to say thank you to you, God, for how good you are. Lord, thank you for loving us so much. Lord, thank you for the access we have to the wise words of Proverbs. Help us to love it. Help us to cling to it. And Lord, help us to not just be hearers of your word, but doers. And Lord, if there's anyone here today that doesn't know you, I pray that today would be the day of their salvation. I pray that they would trust in you, and that they would acknowledge that it's only because of what they believe about you, Jesus. That is what saves them. Nothing else. Help us to remember that too, Father. Thank you, Jesus. And we pray this in your name. Amen.